Sara's Game. Written by Ernie Lindsey. Narrated by Erin Spencer. Chapter 1. Sara was late again. She plowed into her office, greeted by the overpowering scent of cologne and hair gel. Teddy Rutherford, the cliched heir to the throne and obnoxious VP of Research and Development, sat at her desk using her PC to play that little game involving dogs, cats, and giant cannons. Her kids loved it, but she never saw the appeal. As the VP of Marketing for a growing video game company in Portland, Oregon, it was her job to get their Juggernaut series into as many hands as possible. And since she'd been promoted to a marketing position after a decade of 100-hour work weeks as a tester, then up to VP, Light Pulse Productions had grossed more in the past 8 months than over the previous 5 years. Marketing came naturally to her, and nobody in the industry had seen her coming. She had been interviewed in numerous magazines, made it into the upper half of multiple top 40 under 40 lists, and signed a contract to write a monthly column for Professional Mother, all while raising twin girls and their younger brother, alone, since the day their father left for the gym and never came back. She'd been wined and dined with some incredible offers from Fortune 500 companies, but Light Pulse was her home, the house she'd helped build, and she had no intention of leaving, even if it meant dealing with a privileged, spoiled cretin like Teddy on a daily basis. He said, "These guys are pure genius, aren't they? Nothing but flat animations and bright colors and a chance to destroy the enemy with a single click, and people play it for hours. Incredible." He was obtrusive, annoying, and infantile, a 30-year-old man-child who had never had his dad around growing up. Jim spent more hours at the office running Light Pulse than he did at home, and his three ex-wives certainly hadn't been the right women to guide Teddy toward anything resembling a respectable human being. But the fact that he'd been brazen enough to hack into her work account was more than an invasion. She probably would have been less offended if he'd put his hand up her shirt. She took one deep breath, then another, and tucked what she wanted to say back into her throat. Instead, she asked, "How did you get into my system?" He ignored the question. "I mean, really, look at it. I flick, it goes boom. Pieces of wood go flying. Flick, boom, done. After Jugs 3 comes out." That childish nickname again, Sara thought. "We should look at going in this direction. Cut some of the staff, cut some costs, get in good with Apple. Dad said, I mean, Jim said, they were dying to work with us. Put something like this up on the App Store, charge a buck a piece. We can all retire and sip some boat drinks and swap wives." He winked at her. She looked down at the heavy crystal paperweight on her desk, wondering how big the dent in the side of his head would be. "You're trying too hard, Teddy. Now get away from my computer and out of my chair." Teddy stood up, lifted his hands in apologetic resignation, and then squeezed her shoulders as he walked around to the other side. "God, this guy is a harassment lawsuit wearing a fake Rolex. If he ever tried that with some of the hardcore gamer girls out in the belly, he'd be toast." "Sorry," he said. "You shouldn't leave your password written on a sticky note. And you're late. I got bored." "Still not okay, little one." Being the youngest member of the executive team and the owner's son was more of a scarlet letter than a badge of honor, and they all knew that the nickname was the perfect way to knock a couple inches off Teddy's platform loafers whenever he got out of line. Vertically challenged, as he insisted he was, often, he had to look up a good 3 inches at Sara on the days he came into the office wearing unprofessional flip-flops. He straightened the collar of his polo shirt, smoothed out his khakis, and gave a snort of disapproval, but nothing more. Sara smirked. Putty. She laid her tattered and thinning leather briefcase on her desk and took her time unpacking, making Teddy wait on purpose, letting his impatience and ADHD reach a festering point. She was poking the badger, of course, but it was justifiable retribution, and he stayed silent. And while guilt wasn't a word in his vocabulary, or a feeling that had ever impregnated the three brain cells he had floating around in that all-too-polished, bronzer-coated melon, she figured he was at least aware that he'd done something wrong by invading her privacy. She sat, pulled a notepad out of her desk, and chose a pen from her cup with such slow deliberation that Teddy was almost vibrating by the time she finally said, "I can't come up with a marketing plan without a product. So tell me, why are you 2 months behind?" The direct, personalized blame was enough to send Teddy into a barrage of excuses that lasted for over an hour. By the time he was done, and by the time she had tortured him to the point where it was no longer fun, they'd worked out a plan that they could take to gym. A few extra hours per employee on Teddy's side would get them both back on schedule in another month, and Sara would have what she needed to begin a viral marketing campaign. If everything worked out as it should, Juggernaut 3 would demolish the success of its previous two releases. But they had to be ready. Public outcry over production delays was never a good thing, and Sara had no experience in handling the backlash, nor did she want any. Teddy got up, but before he could leave, Sara stopped him at the door. "Teddy!" she called after him. "What?" "If I ever catch you on my PC again..." It was all she needed to say. He hung his head, examined the tops of his shiny Kenneth Coles, and muttered a doleful, "Won't happen again," before he escaped the prison yard of her office. After he walked out, her assistant, Shelley, poked her timid, dimple-cheeked face around the corner. Sara smiled and motioned for her to come in. Shelley crossed through the doorway, one halting step at a time, like she was testing the ground for landmines. "It's definitely Tuesday," Sara thought. "Same blue top every week." Shelley's sense of style was somewhere in the neighborhood of convent chic and librarian demure. Straight hair yanked into a tight ponytail, glasses hanging around her neck by a chain, aging her by 20 years. Plain tops, neutral slacks, and comfortable black loafers that went with everything. Except for Tuesdays, when the splash of blue added life and light to her wardrobe. Which must have been as uncomfortable for Shelley as coloring outside the lines in kindergarten. Sara had never raised her voice at the poor girl, but she always approached Sara as if she would explode and send her running from the office, coated in curse words and insults. Shelley was shy to the point of having trouble interacting with the outside world, but she was a brilliant marketer and had a way with copywriting that could convince a politician to refuse campaign funding. She worked more hours than anyone in the building, constantly refining ad copy and press releases, searching for the perfect words to tell Lightpulse's story, studying the advertising giants of the past like David Ogilvy and John Caples. More than once, Sara had found her asleep at her desk after pulling an all-nighter. For the past 2 months, the girl had been a perpetual motion machine when it came to her job, but her social life consisted of leaving her apartment on Sunday morning to brave the lines at Voodoo Donut and Pals. Sara was positive that Shelley was the smartest person in the office, and had tried to convince her of that once, but the recent San Diego State University grad had refused to accept the compliment. It had been the first and only time she had shown signs of confidence regarding something she believed in, however misguided her intent might have been, in Sara's view. Still, her genius, under Sara's guidance, was a major factor in the success of their advertising and marketing campaigns for their last release. If and when Sara decided to move on, she planned to ask Jim to promote Shelley over some of the other, more seasoned team members as her replacement. But that would all depend on Shelley's ability to leave her fears behind. Sara was working on her, slowly. Any nudge to Shelley's delicate nature that was too forced, too forward, would tilt her in the wrong direction. Sara had seen it before, and was careful in her attempts to build up her introverted assistant's confidence. Sara said, "How's it going, Sarge?" The shortening of Shelley's last name, Sergeant, seemed to please her the first time Sara had used it, so it stuck, and she'd been Sarge ever since. Shelley's voice came out a notch above a whisper. Jacob's school called. They said it was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.